Welcome, Adya. Welcome, Hamid. Thank you for being with us today. And I would like to begin with all of us who have been on a spiritual path all our lives have come across many different definitions, understandings of what realization is. Many of us have had or tapped into some form of realization. But for many of us, the living embodied realization still feels somewhat elusive. I would like to begin by to invite you to share about your own understanding at the moment of what realization is. What does it mean for you? And what was your process, if we can call it a process, of realization? So maybe...
That's all, huh?
Just that.
Well, I mean, as I think we all know, realization is often defined in many, many different ways. And it's one of the confusions about the whole subject of realization or awakening is when people use the word, they're not always talking about the same thing. So it's a really pertinent question to ask anybody when they're going to talk about it. What are they talking about? What are they actually referring to? And even though I'll give it my best attempt, I will have to say that the question's, as I said, is a good question, and it's even more of a relevant question, and yet it's also a question that I always find somewhat uncomfortable. Because the reason is because sort of defining realization for me is, at least, as the years go by, I find it more and more and more and more and more difficult to define it. Or I used to find it much easier years ago, and it gets more and more and more difficult to define it. I think in the most basic sense, to distinguish between the vast array of human experiences and psychological experiences and spiritual experiences and realization or awakening is, to me, awakening always has to have to do with a fundamental shift of identity that is primarily, it leaves its rigid confinement to the psychological structures, to the physical structures. So we no longer have a rigid self-definition in our mind, in our psychology, in our belief, all that, that in some way, identity sort of lets go. Now, what it goes to varies from person to person. From someone can realize total unity. They can feel a great unity or deep intimacy with all of existence. Somebody else can awaken and they see themselves as absolute pure awareness, which is quite distinct in that experience from all of existence. There's various degrees, not all realizations. They have the similarity is the shift of identity to me, is out of any kind of confinement. But what identity shifts into, I think that there are differences in what one realizes and degrees of how deep and profound that realization goes. And then, as my teacher used to say, well, waking up is just getting your foot in the door of reality. It doesn't really mean you know much about what's in there. And it doesn't necessarily mean you know how to manifest it. It just means the door is open now. And you know that it's real. You know what you are. I was talking to somebody yesterday and said, the strange thing is to me, after all these years, is that it seems to me that the truth of our being is the one thing that we can't describe, that we can't talk about, and we can't even talk to ourselves about. Even though that's what we're doing, right? We're talking around it, but we can't directly get a precise definition because it's by its very nature, it's because it's so infinitely inclusive and every definition is only relevant in relationship to something that it's not, that it's the one thing that I can't even talk to myself about, but that I know with a kind of complete clarity. So that's That's the best thing I could do as a starting point.
Would you like to share something about how it unfolded for you? How was
how it's unfolded, you mean?
How it is unfolding? Is it still unfolding, or how?
Sure.
I've heard you speak when you refer to realization that there was a point in time that the switch happened.
Yeah, there was for me. It's not for everybody. I've met people, yes, they kind of go like, oh, wow, yeah, something happened, but I can't tell you exactly when. And there's other people who, where they have a distinct moment where it seemed like sort of the doors of perception opened. And so I had one of those kind of moments, and I would have to say that the fundamental, I would say the absolute nature of reality, that realization hasn't necessarily changed. What has changed and what seems to continue to change is the unpacking of that realization, because we do, after all, have a human life and a human body and a human psychology and emotions and life of relating to life and relating to people. And even though there is no other, we're always relating to others, you know, in some manner or another. And so for me, the unpacking has been, how does that realization actually function? How does it actually function down into not only our experience of our own being, our into our humanity, of which us spiritual people are experts at trying to avoid, but we're stuck with it nonetheless. And so I think my experience is that realization of the ultimate as human beings, we have this infinite capacity to embody it more fully and more clearly. I have never seen an end point to that. I can't imagine an end point. I can't imagine a point where you cross the line and go, well, there you go. I'm a perfect and absolute expression of the infinite. Except, of course, from the infinite's point of view, everything is sort of a perfect expression. But from a human's point of view, we do exist in time, and we're always sort of coming into a deeper functionality on all many, many levels. You know, probably most people in this room, I think the level that sticks out for a lot of people is, if you've had any kind of moment of realization, or just any deeper understanding, if we just got rid of awakening and just everybody in this room has had moments where they understood something much more deeply than they did before. And it's one thing to have that understanding when you're in a room by yourself or walking in nature at a nice, you know, retreat site or an environment that's really conducive. And it's quite another to not only sustain it, but be able to bring it forth and live from it, not only exteriorly, but how we relate to our own psychology, our humanity, our fallibility, you know. That unfolding, it seems to me, is, that's the real journey. That's, awakening is the easy part. Even though it can be tremendously difficult for an awful lot of people, it wasn't easy for me, but the rest of it is requires, I think, kind of a fierce amount of humility and determination. And it continues to this day. I can't imagine an end to it, at least at this point.
I would like to bring Hamid to the conversation.
That's how we do it. This is actualization. We'll talk more about it, what this means. It's a little hint. But, you know, what I just say is that the definition of realization is, there are many meanings to it. There's so many. Because I'm sort of a student of many traditions. I like to study the traditions and everybody, and try to really see what is it they're talking about. You're not hearing me? How about now?
Better.
I said I am a student of many traditions, like to study spiritual traditions. And what do they mean by realization? And after a while, I realized many kinds. So I made my own definition. Now I use my own definition for realization. I said, well, you know, I can't just use whether I have to define it, right? And then I use it according to my definition. And so for me, realization, awakening are distinct things. That took me a long time. So awakening is like waking up from sleep. You sleep, you're identified with the ordinary or conventional view. When you wake up, you realize, oh, it's not like that. Reality is different. It doesn't have those kind of features. You wake up like a light bulb turns on and you see. So that's, for me, that's what's awakening. You really wake up from sleep. You wake up to reality. That doesn't yet address the question of realization, although it's implied in it. Realization, I mean by something specific, which is realization is knowing what is the true nature that you have waken up to, knowing it exactly what it is, and knowing that that is what you are. So realization for me is being the true nature, not me as an individual or mind being true nature. No, I realize I am the true nature that is at this moment knowing itself. So being true nature, being the true nature of being, the true nature of reality, I call that realization. Waking up, you still haven't discerned things enough, because everything seems to be bright and light and true and real and all that. That's the waking up. That's how I define them. I'm not saying anything about anybody else's definitions. I'm telling you my definitions about waking up, about awakening and realization. And then enlightenment is a whole other fallbacks, which I hope we won't get into. Yes. Please, yes, this is something about, is it my beard? Yeah. Okay.
I'm going to embody better sound quality.
So, if we are this awareness, consciousness, knowing, being, whatever you name it, which is aware of itself, then who and what gets realized?
I think this is, Hamid kind of pointed at this in a way, is that it's not a who that awakens. It's the reality that awakens. We wake up from the who.
But isn't the nature of reality to be awake?
What's that?
Isn't the nature of reality to be awake?
Yes. And reality can have the experience of awakening. In my experience, the closer we get, the closer we get to reality, all of a sudden we run into these problems with description, because it's so amazingly paradoxical. Like, yes, it's always awake, it's always present, it's always there, and yet in a human being, we can certainly be completely asleep to it. We can completely not know it or disregard it as if it's not there. So I think that a lot of the conceptual problems that or conundrums that we get into when we describe awakening and whether reality is awake or not awake, these are predominantly philosophical or theological problems. When we come back to actual experience, so many of these problems start to disappear, because experientially we all hold vastly paradoxical experiences that combine totally opposing points of view at the same time. And experientially, this happens to us quite common. But when we get into sort of reasoning it out, or get into any kind of philosophy about it, it's very hard to, because then we get these statements, you know, reality is always awake to itself. Well, yes, but then I had this, seemingly, something had this awakening.
It's actually not true.
Yeah.
Reality is not always awake to itself.
What do you mean?
Well, it's awake to itself, everybody will be awake. It's as simple as that, because everybody is reality.
You see that we have a different opinion already.
Reality is...
Finally!
You see, the thing, you see, that's why I have different distinctions that I think, because this is a big topic, many between teachings and tradition, all of that. You know, when you're awakened, you feel reality is always awake. It feels that way. Well, the person next to you isn't experiencing it that way. You say, even Dogen and the Buddha said, when you're awakened, the whole world is awakened. And I said, well, that's the experience. Mm-hmm. But the fact of it, you know, my neighbor didn't awaken.
You know? Right.
They didn't awaken. So what does that mean?
Right.
Are they not reality? Are they some external thing outside of reality? So we have to admit the fact that there is reality. That's when I make a distinction between reality and true nature. Reality is all that there is and there can be. True nature is its very essence. It's true nature. True nature is complete purity, complete light, complete freedom. But reality can awaken to that or not, because reality also appears as a condition of ignorance. What appears as a condition of ignorance? That's why when I hear people say, I am a non-dual teacher, and I think this person is not awakened because their ignorance. I don't know what you're talking about. Their ignorance? You already split them from reality. You made them something else. It is not their ignorance, it's reality's ignorance appearing through that individual. So reality as a whole, I have another term which I actually prefer over reality. I call it total being, meaning everything that is, everything that everybody experiences, everything that ever was, everything that was ever experienced, everything that would ever be, everything that would ever be experienced by everybody. All of that, I give it the term total being, because there is nothing that is possible, was, or will be, that is outside of total being. Now, total being has its heart, or its true nature, which is what people call true nature, Buddha nature, or pure awareness, and all of that. But total being also includes ignorance. Some of the teachings, like if you listen to Dzogchen teaching, they talk about innate ignorance, primordial ignorance. I mean, the consciousness is born ignorant, and the ignorance is not learned. Where does it come from? Reality itself, or total being, has both dark and light, has ignorance. It's possible for it to manifest itself in such a way that it is ignorant. I mean, Maher Baba said it. Remember what he said? He said God has three conditions. One, when he's in total sleep, called the divine coma. People call it annihilation or cessation. Other condition is the condition of a limited individual in the world. The other condition is God aware of himself as the omnipotent, omnipresent beingness of everything. But he didn't say but he said that the limited individual is God, experiencing itself as a limited individual. So God can express itself, herself, as ignorance. So awakening happening, other thing, when you ask what awakens, it is our reality or the being awakens, but it also, it doesn't awaken in vacuum. We don't know whether stones get awakened. We don't know whether crocodiles get awakened. We know human beings get awakened. So this reality or total being awakens through an individual, through individual being. And this individual being is an expression of total being, the totality of being, which is, I won't say non-dual, it is beyond dual or non-dual. The question dual and non-dual is irrelevant to it in some sense, because it's everything, and the question separation and connection are irrelevant. But it expresses itself as everything, including all the ignorance, and expresses itself as the being who are ignorance, who at some point awaken. So the awakening of total being to itself happens through an individual. Ajah, when he awakened, it was reality awakening, but happened through the individual called Adam. It didn't happen through somebody else, you know. So Adam as an individual, a human being, whatever that we define that, is an important part of awakening. Mm-hmm. So you could say the individual awakens, or better to say, total being or reality awakens through that particular individual. It hasn't awakened through another individual. Although its nature, when it's awakened, recognizes its inherent nature as a primordially self. Primordially pure awareness, but awareness, remember, requires the individual for it to be aware. Awareness can never be anonymous. Awareness by itself cannot be aware of things on its own. It has to be aware through beings who are aware. And that's why it requires an individual human being for it to wake up to itself.
So I'm very curious. I would like to make, and I would like to hear, Arjun, do you agree with that statement that reality or true nature, whatever word, I'm not sure which word you use as a pointer, that awakens through an individual consciousness or individual? Is this your perspective? Or your experience?
Yeah, okay. So, the older I get, the less inclined I am to speak about this, even though it will sound like it, in any sort of philosophical terms, because I think it's all made up. I'm not saying you're making anything up, don't get me wrong. I'm just saying, that's why it's hard for me to have, because I always come back to, like, what can we experience? I can report to you what we can experience. How I interpret my experience, I'm not nearly as certain about that as I am with what I've experienced, right? So there's an experience of awakening, there's an experience of embodiment, there's an experience of all sorts of things, there's the experience of as Hamid said, and I said in a different language, in a different way, when awakening happens, it very much feels as though the whole world has woken up. That's the experience. If you took that as a philosophical statement, right, then you get yourself in a lot of debate happens, right? I think one of the reasons that, you know, we often get confused spiritual teachings and traditions and teachers and people that are seeking is we gradually start to move away from experience into our interpretations, and of course, we all have our interpretations. I have my interpretations. But when we give our interpretations more validity than when we do our experience, I think that's why it's hard for me to go, if you ask me, so what do I think about what Almaas says? I go, gee, everything Almaas just said, I go, I can find that. So far, I can find every bit of it in my experience. So I can go, yes, I can totally confirm what he has said. But then if you asked me more like in an more abstract form, okay, does that mean that, you know, that is it reality that awakens? Is it an individual that awakens? I think, well, first of all, in my experience, I come back and I don't even, at a certain point, what I realize is I don't even know what we're talking about anymore. In the sense, by that I mean, that reality and an individual, I think part of awakening shows us they're the same. A fragile human being and the ultimate reality is actually the same. We can have different experiences of, you know, the human experience, the humanity aspect of the reality is certainly a different experience than the vastness of awareness or consciousness. But I think part of what realization shows us is actually these ways that we divide the world, or as you talked about, even dividing the world in terms of truth and illusion, as if they come from two different places. As if there's one, as if we, because we often talk about, well, there's just the one. And then we say, well, the one is truth. And then somehow this illusion thing snuck in. And there's only the one, but well, where did that come from? Well, it came from somewhere else. Well, if it came from somewhere else, how can it only all be the one? You see, it can't. So clearly, from this primordial ground of being, the entirety of everything we'll ever experience arises and plays itself out. Part of that's awakening, part of that's going to sleep, part of that's suffering, bliss, awakening, confusion. And it just so happens that these more confused states are not satisfactory to reality, at least as it manifests as a human being. They're not satisfactory. We don't like them. We feel this impetus to not suffer. I think we feel all those also an impetus to become, within life, there seems to be an impetus to become more conscious. And we are, our spiritual search is born out of that universal impetus. Do you know? It's otherwise, if we didn't have the impetus, we'd suffer, but we would never get out of it.
Whose spiritual search?
The human beings.
Well, what's the human being? My body?
Your body, is your feelings, body? Your emotions.
Uh-huh.
But all there, of that.
Yes, but I also recognize the human being. The interesting thing about human being that I see, seeing you, for instance, and others, the human being is this fundamental truth, whatever we call it.
Yes.
At the same time, simultaneously, it expresses itself in time and space. It is beyond time and space, but expresses itself in a particular location, time and space. That particular location has many properties that can be actually known and experienced directly. Mm-hmm. And that, what I call the essence of, it's not just a human being, it's an individual consciousness. Consciousness or awareness individualizes itself into the same consciousness, but individuated.
Yes.
And that then manifests a mind and a body to function through.
Okay, so, I'm with you.
And in fact, one of the people who mentioned that, which I like again, I'm bringing Mahar Baba again, which is, I thought it was a nice expression. He said, the divine manifests himself in the world of illusion as the soul that you are.
It's a nice poetic way to put it.
You see, soul is a poetic way of what I mean by an individual consciousness. Mm-hmm. It's like, I don't know what you say, I mean, I said it.
You said it very well.
So
you gave a nice definition.
And as you said, there are sort of interpretation, mm-hmm. and my word for it is approximations. Mm-hmm. I mean, I keep finding, each, you know, as the time passes, there are better approximations of how I could say it.
Of course.
There's always approximation.
Right. There are, of course, more and less accurate.
You can never say the whole thing completely, 100% exactly.
So what I'm sensing, so there's some teachings that do not... they deny the existence of personal consciousness or an individual. And clearly, I think you're not part of this notion of teachings. I think, Adya, you talk about true autonomy. Mm-hmm. Meet you, in your work, you encourage students to inquire into personal content and psychodynamic experience. So is personal consciousness or individual the conduit for realization? And
can you repeat that again?
Is personal consciousness necessary, or an individual in your perspective, for the realization, or to bring it to experience, to make it less? I would like to
ask a question. I'm not understanding how it's
you know that
how it's relevant.
How it's relevant to the conversation.
Well, in other words, it. So part of our discussion is around the whole. I mean, I'm using a different word, I think, than in the write-up, what it is to actually sort of live, embody this, and, you know, and that has tremendous challenges to it, right? And it seems to me that we could, which does happen all the time, we could get sort of hung up on lots of little issues where we're not really talking about, like, actual people's real experience that they're having difficulty with, you know, like, in other words, somebody has some realization and they're really seeing bright and clear and they're wonderful, and then they go home and they get in an argument and it all goes down the toilet. And then they come to a spiritual teacher like me or Almaas, or you've probably heard many of them talking in conferences like this and probably talking to you as well. It's one of the most common questions we get, you know, is I have these moments of clarity. And what does that mean? What is that sort of process of that clarity coming into life? And so, you know, I think, you know, for me, because one of the things that I love about Almaas, and I tend to like things about other people that are different from me, because I actually appreciate differences and diversity and...
You like me, I like people like that.
Yeah, we do like each other. Right?
I like
Boy, you're warm, too. I feel like a wizard wanting to...
That's how I learn. How am I going to learn if I don't find people different from me?
But one of the things I've always appreciated about you is that Almaas, he has this extraordinary intelligence and realization coupled together, this extraordinary curiosity that loves to go in and really go through the deep minutiae of experience and realization and really kind of pull it all apart, whereas for me, I'm kind of by nature a sort of a broad strokes person. Like I'll throw a word out like I did before. I'll just go our humanness, and I'll kind of just go, okay, everybody knows what our humanness is, you know, almost instinctually. That's granted, that's a very imprecise way to use the word, right? I'm counting on people's almost visceral sense of, yeah, my humanness, you know, whatever that means for you.
Yeah, what does that mean?
Right.
What does it mean? Right. Yeah.
I mean, you're talking
and
about
that
me
question is
and
written.
You, and there are obviously there are two, although we know we're one. Right. So what makes us two?
Right.
We know what makes us one. That's the true nature of awakening.
That's
but
what
makes
about
us
so
two?
Let's talk about
is it
about
just our physical bodies? If it's our physical body, that means we're going to be gone after we die?
Yeah.
Or are we continue being friends?
I hope so we'll be friends either way.
Yeah.
Let's talk about Adya humanness.
Yeah.
So...
My intention wasn't to discount the question at all. You know, that wasn't really my intention.
It's okay if it happened.
Thank you.
It was that I think that, you know, when I then when I look into some of these, you know, as I look into these issues, you know, the longer I do this, and I've been at this 18 years now, it isn't that long, but it's a while, is the more and more I find myself coming back to the issues that I think many of us really live with and the challenges that all of us human beings have in our day-to-day lives, you know, and speaking really, really honestly about what realization is, about what our experience is, and really addressing those very sort of human concerns, you know, I think is really, really important. So I'm just wanted to make that link between the question and these, and the real struggles that people have.
Would you like to bring some of those issues that you encounter in working with students, like what comes up, or what was for you in your experience, how...
In my experience? It's always a good place to start, self-revealing.
Let's make it personal.
I don't think, I mean, we all have, number one, each person has a very unique journey. There are definitely predictable characteristics that unfold. But I think mine was a lot like a lot of people when I had my first real big opening at 25 years old. You know, you put almost an infinite amount of fearlessness into a 25-year-old kid, and that's not, you know, doesn't have his all of his emotional baggage completely under control, even though he had some great awakening. And it's a volatile sort of mixture. And I think a lot of people that I've met have experienced that as well. You can have a place of clarity, but a whole other part of human development can be, you know, we can take a light shift in terms of realization, but another part of our development can be sort of lagging behind, kind of trying desperately to catch up and extremely confused about why can I be so wise, and then in an instant, I'm saying something or acting in a way that I know isn't true, and I know isn't real, and I do it anyway. And of course, that's what I found myself doing, time after time after time, and it was very confusing, and it was frustrating, and, you know, all the kind of things I think that anybody, goes through. And fortunately, I think for me, I always had a very broad interest. So I was, of course, a very serious Zen practitioner, so it was hours of cushion, hours and hours of every day on the cushion. But I also, at that time, you know, consumed great amounts of psychological textbooks. I mean, real serious stuff. You know, I probably consumed 100 books on psychology, which really helped me out to understand.
I thought you were going to say consumed a lot of LSD.
Fortunately, no. For some of the people it might help. I don't know. It didn't help for me. So, you know, and other things. Really, I think, I'm painting an extremely wide brush.
You have a lot of psychological sophistication. For being a non-dual teacher, you're very psychologically sophisticated. Really.
From you, that's a compliment. From a radical non-dualist, that's definitely
a compliment. This guy knows a little bit about psychology, not just about awakening.
I've read some of your books, too. Yeah.
That helps.
In fact, I read some of your books at that time.
Oh, yeah, you did. Okay, good. So I'm appreciating that you bring into the question about, okay, now we awaken and realize what's next? Mm-hmm. What happened to all the difficulties? How do we live it? Because that's our theme. Yeah. I think maybe we should focus on that.
Yeah. I think one of the first thing where it all starts is like the realization after realization, which is the realization of, oh, that doesn't solve all of my problems. That doesn't make me a Superman. It's huge and significant and life-altering and changing, but there's more to the story. And that's its own realization, and sometimes it's hard to admit that, you know, because a lot of us thought, oh, I just kind of have some big awakening enlightenment experience, and I cross the line and thank you very much. I'm done. And then we realize, well,
that's what everybody wants.
Everybody wants that. Yeah. Anybody with any good sense wants it.
Yeah.
It just doesn't work out that way.
Yeah, and then many stories are told that way, which makes people feel hopeful. But it's a good question because this is a big topic. It reminds me actually of a story about Dogen. Dogen Zenji, founder of the Soto school of Zen, one of the two Japanese school of Zen. In his old age, before he died, he was walking with a friend, and a friend asked him, Dogen, how's your realization doing? And he said, my realization is doing pretty good. However, my body is still having difficulty going along with it. Remember, this is considered a quite enlightened human being who is the founder of one of the major schools of Zen and who is now is, people refer to Dogen as the master. You see, that's what he said towards the end of his life. It shows the difficulty of how to bring realization into everyday life through the body, through the heart, through the mind, through all situation. How can I be the truth that I have woken up to in all those situations? That's not an easy thing. It's like awakening is a piece of cake compared to it. And that is a process. It's not an experience. See.
Would you like to talk about how, and I know you have a different approach, is how do you ground your students, or how do you work with your students in grounding the experience of their realization, yeah. if we would refer well, as an experience.
Yeah, that's a big subject, because it's a huge area, you know. It's I don't kind of go, well, you just do this, right. and you do this, and yeah. you do this. I start, again, because we have limited time, I'll speak in more a little more broad strokes. The broad strokes that I always start with is a very, it sounds like an easy thing, but it's very difficult, and we all, I think we grow into it over usually many years, that when the thing for any of us that's really difficult is to be really completely and absolutely honest with ourselves. I think a lot of it starts there, that we come out of hiding. That doesn't mean we're not confused anymore. Sometimes to be honest is to admit how confused we are. But to be honest with oneself, totally true with oneself, to me it's not sort of how to deal with all the issues, but it's the vital thing that begins to open the door. And I say that because of the way I teach, I often shoot for trying to get people to have some awakening experience soon instead of at the end of the process. So I shoot for that soon. What can happen though is you have this access to this clarity, but it's also easy for sort of the ego to hide in that clarity and to say, well, this really isn't happening, or this really, or there may be a problem, but there's nobody to own the problem or have the problem, or there's lots of ways that we can kind of hide from ourselves, sorry to use the word, my friend, but to hide from our humanness or our humanity, our fallibility. Sounds like a small thing, but it's a big step to really, really come out of hiding. Honesty is the first step, and it's a big one. It's a really, really big one. And once you take that step, then there's, depending on what the person's dealing with, there's very specific ways, because everyone's so different, right? They have different paths. Some people were, you know, had loving parents and seemed to avoid most of the overwhelming traumas of life, and some people just have experienced the most overwhelmingly difficult lives, and you know, they will go through very different journeys.
And what do you mean by honesty? What does it mean for you?
No longer lie to yourself. No longer lie to yourself. Mm-hmm. I know it's a broad stroke, but it's just, and sometimes, you know, we have to be sort of coaxed into that. I mean, it doesn't happen all at once. It's not something you just go, okay, I won't lie to myself. It's a journey. What does that even mean? Your question's good. What does it even mean for me to be completely and totally honest with myself? And a lot of that is starting to just see, again, our experience. You know, am I clear here? In that conversation, was I clear? How about my reaction to that when I, you know, contracted or got angry or got jealous or just to say, oh, I got angry. I got jealous, I really did. And it sounds simple, but the strange thing is, in the world of spirituality, you know, somebody walking down the street may be more likely to do that than somebody that's involved in spirituality. Because everyone's walking around trying to be so untouched by everything, you know, that it can be hard to sort of kind of admit everything, you know. I mean, again, this is just the sort of the beginning, but to me there's a whole other part of realization. There is what I think of as qu- quite, at least experientially, literally an up and outward movement is why I think the word waking up is a great word, because it literally is up. It's almost like some spirit leaps up and out.
In fact, essence.
All traditional Zen, they used to call it they used to depict waking up as the leaping of spirit, whip up and out. And that's one of the traditional definitions. It's a totally transcendent movement, right? Outside of space and time and all that. You don't need me to describe that anymore. But then I think there's another movement that's actually spirit moving down and in. And that is a very experiential movement of spirit. It's moving down and in to the humanity, and it is endeavoring to embody. And as it does that, boy, does it start to put pressure on the dark places, the unresolved psychological material, anything that you don't want to look at, you'll feel increasing pressure put on it. It will become harder and harder and harder and harder to sustain not being honest when that descent happens. And a lot of times people can spend years in the vastness of emptiness. Because it's very safe and you really are untouched and nothing ever did happen and nobody was ever born and all that's so true there and it's so experientially real. And then often when you least expect it, it starts to sort of descend back down. The image I always loved is the image at the beginning of the Bible when Jesus is in the River Jordan and opens up and he didn't wake up and out, right? The heaven split open and the dove descended upon him, as the spirit descended in him. And when you read like the whole Christian message, that's the descent message. That's the embodied descent message. Often what we get from the East is more the waking up message. Well, it's the Buddha sitting in the lotus posture.
The whole Christian story, actually, if we take it as a metaphor, is the story of Christ, Jesus. Is God becomes a human being. I mean, what more of a descent can that, you know, than that? You know? But that's the whole idea in Catholicism, is that the divine, beyond everything, becomes a human being that suffers. But to get back to the question of living realization, I think, the idea of descent, I think it's important. But first we need to realize that having an awakening, an experience of awakening, is still not realization. To start talking about living our realization is not the time for it yet, before realization happens. Because just having an awakening, it's an experience and it's not established. It has to be established first. Established as what I call a station. I mean, every time you're rested, that's what you are, where you are. When that is established, the question of, you know, living it becomes important. Now, usually, I'm going to use another Zen metaphor. For some reason, I'm sitting next to you, I have all these Zen things come to me. You know, Zen has this way of looking at things, says, there is realization and there is actualization. They call the living it actualization. And for Zen, much of the time, realization comes first, actualization comes second. Other traditions actually reverse it. Actualization first, it's that you work through the stuff, you purify and clarify and all of that, and then the awakening happens, and then you're already a clear vessel through which spirit can flow through, you see. So we need to first clarify that. In the path I follow, actualization and realization are two processes going together, simultaneously, hand in hand. They're intertwined. Like the more there is realization, the more there is actualization. The more there is actualization, the more there is realization. That's the path I follow, but the different paths are different. But one thing I find useful is that in the process of actualization, like realized I know what I am and absolute stillness of being or silence and awareness, how do I live my everyday life, right? How do I talk to my friend, how drive my car and all that? And what I found in my experience is that as a process of learning to express that in life, the realization itself changes. The process of actualization furthers the realization. And that's again, you go back to Zen Dogen, he says, realization realizes further realization. For him, this is not just realization. Realization realizes further realization. Realization has no end. So it's not like we reach the omega place of reality and then we actualize that. You see, it's more like we reach through nature, which has different people experiences in many ways because it has many facets, it has many faces. And as we learn, we try, we work on or practice, or we're impelled to live that. My experience is that the realization itself begins to change. I was surprised by it because I thought, well, I'm this emptiness, and I think it's this emptiness going to live. And I realized what happened as I started living and seeing the difficulty and working with the difficulty, I realized that that emptiness has become presence, for instance. It's not just emptiness, it's a fullness and a richness of presence. And that the presence is closer to the physical body than the emptiness. And that for the realization to involve the physicality, which is part of the descent, as you mentioned, because it has to involve the body, the belly, which means dealing with all of our instincts and needs and all of that. And so those can flow with the spiritual nature. Realization has to change. And my experience is not only there is an intertwining of realization and actualization, and that intertwining means actualization is a process. But realization, which can be an experience and a juncture, quantum leap, can become a process. There are many quantum leaps in my experience. Like, I've come to so many places where I felt that's it, that I stopped believing that. And now I don't think that's it. I think there are things yet to come. And I'm very happy about that. I don't know them yet, you see. That's what Caesar's discovery means. Mm-hmm. Reality is going to know itself in a way it may be never known itself through anybody ever. That's why I don't think any teaching has the final truth, because the final truth never been said yet. It will never be said yet, because there isn't one.
Now, I think that it's not a danger, but it's one of those things that whenever we touch upon a deeper realization of reality, in my experience, the hallmark experientially, one of the hallmarks is it always feels complete and final.
Exactly. Right?
And so
it feels certain.
It feels certain. So of course for a while we think.
Right. Yes, but when you have many of those certainties, you start wondering, well, what was certain last year about that? Now I'm certain about something completely different.
Right.
What does this truth of certainty is?
That's what I found out when I realized that's just a hallmark of touching upon reality. It has certainty, and it doesn't mean.
When we are young in our realization, we think that's it.
Yes.
That it's the proof, but a spiritual experience, it's very nature, because it's just the truth. It has that certainty.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I love that since you mentioned Dogen, his whole impetus for his search was when he did hear the sort of the Zen, the real radical non-dual Zen teaching, is that everything is already inherently Buddha.
Yeah.
And yet the same teachers that were saying this for hundreds of years would have monasteries where monks sat for hours a day meditating, and he just couldn't put it together. And he went all over the place asking Zen masters, if everything is already inherently Buddha, why do we not have to practice? And fortunately, none of those masters gave him an answer that was satisfactory, because he had to find it in himself. And his experience, and you just talked about his experience, was actually the answer. Everything he ever wrote was actually the answer to that one koan that he began with. And here we are in the modern day, and this same kind of question goes on. You know, if everything is already inherently the one reality, then why do we have to do anything, you know, to realize it? Conceptually, it seems like a great question, you know, and of course it's a great koan for him. And yet, I think Almaas was just giving a great reason why, because it's not, there isn't an end to any of it, you know, as much as we want there to be an end, mostly so we can cross the finish line, hoist our enlightenment flag, and make sure our neighbors see it, you know, but, you know, but we realize that through the process of living, and I think it's also one of the things of just getting older, if things go right, there's a lot of great things about aging that we don't talk about much, that that we stop being so radically goal-oriented, because living enough years and having enough experience keeps showing us that even our deepest realizations can keep unfolding and unfolding and unfolding and unfolding. And it seems like the infinite has an infinite capacity to display itself. Do you know? And it's enlivening, and it's also humbling, because then none of us kind of gets to go, I've got it all. Yeah. Do you know, look at me, I've got the whole thing, and I'm right and everybody else is wrong. But that also feels really good. You know, that feels really, really good to drop that kind of nonsense.
I love when we went to India to interview some of Nisargadatta's students, one of the women there said it in a very simple way. She said, once you realize and you have realization, after that you just drink it daily. That's it. No, you. Mm-hmm. And then the rest, it just take care of itself. It has a force of itself that reveals itself somehow.
I think, you know,
it does keep going.
No, I was thinking, you know, what we're saying, what we're doing is useful. I want to particularize it more, you know, make it more specific so it could be more useful for people who hear it, which is the process of living realization. Process actualization, the way some of my approximations is that it involves two intertwining processes. I'm not talking now about realization and actualization. I'm saying actualization itself has two processes. And these two processes, one of them is that of a deconstruction or a clarification. And the other process is of a development or an evolution. So that takes us back to the human being, the organ through which reality wakes up. That organ is already weighed with many beliefs and ideas and history and patterns, right? And delusions and ignorance. And even when we wake up, we have lots of delusion left. That's why one of the chapters of my new book is called Delusion After Realization. In fact, Dogen talked about that frequently, you know, delusion after enlightenment. Even when somebody wakes up, the fact that they woke up saw reality, that doesn't mean they saw through all their delusion, all their belief, all their ideas, all their the impressions on their mind and heart and body of the history, you know, of the pain and the difficulties, historical influences, social influences, family influences. influences, race, physical influences, biological, all these influences are in the consciousness, and the consciousness need to be divested of that. And that is a process. It's not the awakening doesn't completely just delete it. Doesn't, there's no delete button. You can't delete the whole thing. You have to really go through it and see it, and that's the not lying to yourself. You need to see your hatred, your jealousy, your, the fact that you believe, one of the things, big obstacles to actualization is that the person, when they begin to act, they become a separate individual because they still have deep inside them action, activity has to do with an individual acting. When they realize, when they are, or they know they're a vastness, they know they're an indeterminate kind of mystery, they become this known entity that acts. That is the delusion. And the person needs to recognize that and feel it and experience it and say, why do I still believe that? What's the forces behind it? So that's what I call the process of clarification, clarifying the consciousness. The other process, which is also important, which the clarification doesn't, clarification means you clarify the water, you clarify the medium of experience so it's completely transparent for the true nature to show itself. It's like clear window, the light comes through, nothing obstructed. So all the dirt is gone. The other process is that the light cannot come through completely through this window because the window needs to develop, needs to become more like a crystal. It needs to have features and capacities and need to have qualities that are necessary for true nature to express itself fully. And that is what I call process of maturation. That's aging is part of it. The body ages, the mind ages, the heart ages, but the consciousness itself, the humanness, matures. It can mature. There is a maturation, spiritual maturation. And the maturation is not simply knowing the same thing longer. The maturation means the same thing that you know comes in contact with life situation that brings up qualities of true nature necessary for that situation that become part of what we are. So it's a process of immersing ourselves in life and dealing with it in a way from the realization. So, which requires the clarification, but it requires the consciousness to evolve because for a certain time, it's not capable. The consciousness is not capable of letting that much energy, that much force, that much awareness to come through. It has to become more capable. And that is an evolution and a growing thing. Just like a body grows, the human consciousness grows, needs to mature. That is, doesn't exist in old traditions, but many traditions do have it.
And I think life itself is the crucible that brings these to the fore and develops those avenues through which spirit can operate. I think there's one other thing that I'd like to say too is that, again, I keep saying this, I don't know, maybe because I've been teaching 18 years, I know Almaas has been at this a lot longer, but so that's developed over the years is that I've found that the necessity for real open-heartedness, you know, I think something that unlocks so much, so even unlocks confusion in us and sorrow is a really deeply, deeply open, intimate heart. You know, the element of love, which I remember when I was, you know, studying in Zen, they have compassion, and compassion's its own quality, a particular quality of love, which is extremely important. But there is a kind of, there is a quality of love that really deeply opens us and really makes us available. It's to me, love is very intimately linked with what I talked about earlier, with that ability to be honest. It's hard to be honest with yourself if you don't really have a deep kind of access to love. To a love for your own humanity. I tell people all the time, the hardest thing you'll ever accept fully is your own humanity. Once you got that, you will have accepted everybody else's in the world. You know, to really accept it, to really love it, and to really have a real love or compassion for other people, to be able to not just see what's happening for them, but to really have a real deep tenderness for what's happening for all of us, for the whole human experience. You know, this quality of love, which I think is also part of the descending movement, is extremely, extremely important, and often is not, I think, not emphasized enough, especially within sort of non-dual circles. It's sometimes seen as, well, love, it's, you know, that gushy thing you do over there when you're chanting bhajans, and, you know, let's get over that. And I'm not necessarily talking about creating like an emotional love, trying to whip up some emotion, but I mean really the opening of the heart, which is a really profound. And there's the human heart, sort of the psychological, and there's the deep spirit opening of the spiritual heart, which is almost overwhelming.
There's no actualization if there's no heart.
I don't think so.
Either. A path with no heart is really not a real path. Mm-hmm. You know, Don Juan said that, remember? But, right. You know, the thing that Ajay bring, the importance of the heart, mm-hmm. that... which again, descent is not just in the head, because sometimes they awaken. For many people, their head awakened. I mean, literally true that there's a light bulb appears in the head. The head becomes clarity and light, and the one can see reality, can be awakened. They don't know yet their heart hasn't awakened. They don't know yet that their belly hasn't awakened. I know many. Realized individual who live here. And I remember going to one famous non-dual teacher to talk about everything is oneness, everything, there's no individual, everything is just one. And I left there feeling like I was just a head and my body was dangling. That was his condition. It was true he was experiencing that he was from here, not from here. Because experience for me is a whole other thing. You feel the love, the compassion, the tenderness, the juiciness, the nectars of true nature. Because true nature is not just awareness. Awareness can flow as honey through the heart. And the honey can come through the fingers when you touch a friend. See? That is part of actualization. That's part of living. But that means both the conscious need to be clarified and the body need to be clarified. So the heart, that brings in the Gurdjieff ideas that a human is a three-brained being. The head, the heart, and the belly or the body. And they are all equally important, valid, and necessary. And the awakening need to happen in all of them.
They're very distinct ways awakening shows up.
Right? They're actually very distinct. Like different tradition emphasize, like, you know, the bhaktis.
Yeah.
It's all heart or all surrender, all melting. And but they don't necessarily understand anything. Right. And then they're the ones who are clear mind, emptiness, clarity, and transparency. Mm-hmm. The belly is a whole other thing. It's more no bullshit. Right, right. I am a mountain here, imperturbable, immovable mountain. That is more the awakening of the belly. We need all of those, and all of those requires a new realization, but also our humanity need to both be clarified and matured so that our true nature, the pure awareness, present all its these qualities. So that means all... This what's called subtle physiology, the three brains or the three center, or some people call it chakra, all need to be activated and clarified from their occlusion around them and need to evolve to become what they can be. And the process of evolution is endless.
There's a wonderful way that Dogen, because you mentioned him, talked about unity. Because as you said, you can, when you have that awakening on the level of mind, I call it, vast emptiness, you can experience a kind of, seeing a kind of unity. But it's different than like what when Dogen described his experience of unity, he called it an absolute intimacy with the 10,000 things. Because the unity up here is not necessarily intimate. It's just, it's like a fact. You see it, you know it. But when it's here, it's the experience of the intimacy, which is very, very different, right? It's something comes alive, and yet the experiential quality is like absolute closeness, you know? And then, of course, as you mentioned down here, as in Zen, we call this the mountain of emptiness. The great mountain, but and each part of these places have their own ways of hiding. There's the intellectual hiding with beliefs and opinions and just misunderstanding. There's the emotional shutting down that almost everybody knows that's ever gotten their feelings hurt or fell out of love or, you know, all those kinds of ways that we can emotionally shut down, which makes it harder to open. And then, of course, down here is where all the fear, the ultimate fear of non-existence is, and I think a lot of people, you know, it's like whenever someone talks to me with fear, if they sit and talk to me for a few minutes, 99% of the time, their hand will eventually go right here. It doesn't go here. It doesn't go, oh, I'm experiencing so much. It always goes down here, the ultimate existence.
Yeah. I just want to, one last remark to... So I hear you speaking of like virtues of realization, just to make sure it's not something we're going to strive for now to open our hearts or to
is it not something we strive
it's you're speaking about flavors of realizations, right? It's not it's not another process we're going to follow, how to open our hearts or how to...
It depends on the person. I mean, if someone's sort of in emptiness and they've been there long enough, and yet they're really defended, then it's time to like go, no, okay, now we really have to shoot at opening that heart. We really need to focus on that. You know, because if you really clear up here, but your heart's not open, you know, as soon as you go into any place that has to do with emotion, whether it's your own or when you relate with other people and the whole emotional body gets going, it all falls apart. If that's the case, then you do really need to specifically...
But then maybe the realization to begin with, maybe it was not complete. If it didn't take care of itself...
Yeah, but if we start from a position that says that there may not be any such thing as 100% complete realization, do you know what I mean? And at least, you know, through our human experience of that realization, I have yet to meet anybody, and I've seen hundreds and hundreds of people awaken, and I've never seen anybody get the whole ball of wax all at the same moment and be able to function from it and, you know, and never be conflicted. I'm not saying it can't happen, but I'm saying I've never seen it.
But maybe it's not necessary. It's a construct that we have imposed.
I understand what you're saying. Okay, I get what you're saying. Yeah, you can look at this as like the idea is to become sort of Superman or Superwoman, super functional on every level of being. I think what we're talking about, certainly what I'm talking about, is not being superhuman at all. In fact, that's one of the things you got to climb off of that mountain of trying to be superhuman, which there's that in certain forms of spirituality too. And trying to develop into the perfectly integrated, balanced, you know, well, I'd like to meet that person. I've never met him yet. But having said that, this isn't about being a perfect person or being extraordinarily functional equally in every domain. It's like having a basic level of realization functioning throughout all the levels of your being. I'm not saying perfectly functioning, but I mean the heart is open and it's functional. The gut is open and it's functional.
Yeah, but including the body,
the heart, all of it.
The mind, all of it. And that's, I am.
There we go.
I am, okay. I said, that the body, the heart, and the mind need to be all included in the realization. One thing you see, even the people who mentally realize don't understand that the realization of development, when I say maturation, people think maturation of the mind mean you're capable of clarity and emptiness. They don't think of it that, and they think of that as freedom from the thinking mind. But there is the to actually live life, you need to think. So how can you be emptiness that thinks? That's not easy. You see, it's possible, and we could approximate it to various degrees, but to really live life, we need to move. Emptiness need to move, need to love, interact, but also need to think, need to discriminate. And emptiness thinking is a whole other story. Doesn't mean there's no words, doesn't mean there's no concept. No, concepts are there, words are there, but you use them. And the presence itself uses the words and thinks through them, and the thoughts are luminous, become luminous. They don't disappear. In the beginning stages, thoughts disappear, you become quiet. The deeper stages, thoughts come back again as an expression of the clarity. So clarity bursts through the thoughts, and your thoughts penetrates reality, and you have greater insights about your life, what you need to do about other people. Not only that, as the mind begins to develop, you begin to know the mind of another. You can know the thoughts of another, or at least you know how to speak to them in a way that they can understand. Gurdjieff had the capacity, for instance, not many people develop it, that he can make the other know what he's, hear him speaking in their head. That's a capacity that develops with the mind. Super sort of capacity, not everybody needs to do it, but we need to know it, that it is a continual process. There's no, it's not like we reach a perfection now, and that's why there's master of so many kinds, because each has developed, matured differently, matured certain part of their potential. They haven't actualized the totality of potential, because their potential is infinite. You need, you know, billions of years, and you're still not going to completely actualize it. But it's fun. That's life, right? You're living. You're truly living.
Yeah. And I think also to kind of come back to what you were asking about too, you know, even if we have some ability to operate on all these levels of being, you know, in a more or less clear way, there's still, we're all each going to have our own particular strong point, you might say. Some people are really going to be, that awakening level of mind is going to be their dharma. Some, the heart thing, that's going to be their dharma. So it's not that everybody is supposed to have this completely balanced. That's an idea too. Our nature doesn't really operate that way. It's just to have it really functional and operational to a certain degree, I think, is, well, as my teacher used to say, which I really appreciated, and she had said, you know, this is all just growing up. And she always likened it to a natural process. This isn't what I'm talking about. I think what either one of us are talking, correct me if I'm not correct in this for you, is that we're not necessarily, in my experience, that everything I've talked about are things that I didn't have these as ideas to begin with. They just kind of, there's a way that things just unfold, like our life unfolds, like we grow up. And then there's a time when we move into different capacities, and that realization moves into a different place. And we don't need to necessarily be trying to have it as an ideal of being the perfect person. We just need to be honest enough and paying close enough attention just to watch when it starts to mature into the next domain of our experience.
and then be willing to really put our attention there without any ideas of perfectionism, you know, and then, because there is a, if you get too heavy-handed, if you try to lock yourself into a program, okay, I'm going to open this and this and this, and it's all going to look this way, then you are leading the way, rather than attuning yourself to a more natural kind of development. And to me, it's actually a, even though you need sometimes a lot of assistance and a lot of help, it's the process, it's natural. It wants to happen.
It's natural, yeah.
It's not something we have to make up and improve.
It's the nature of being to do that. But we need to learn not to lie to ourselves.
That's right.
We need to confront the difficulty. We need to confront our limitations, that there are natural limitations. There are things we don't know, we haven't developed, things we don't know about ourselves. We need to be willing. We need to be open, basically. And after a while, the openness, seeing the difficulty, seeing the limitation, is not a letdown. For a while, it feels like a letdown, feel like I failed. After a while, I said, no, it's an opportunity. There's a further realization that's possible here.
That's the next place.
Yeah, the next place could be life changer.
Yeah.
You know, so every limitation, every difficulty becomes a portal, but we need to recognize the limitation, which means we need to be humble, completely humble.
You see. I would like to take one or two questions from the audience. So, right there.
Technology.
Hello. Okay. Yeah. Thanks for a great discussion. We are here at a conference on basically our entanglement, and we have been hearing a lot about quantum mechanics and possibly how consciousness is related to quantum mechanics. And there have been some models of how that works, and John Hagelin this morning spoke about how consciousness is part of the unified field. And so I'd like to ask your opinion about this. I'm going to be presenting several different models, one is which consciousness arises from quantum mechanics or some kind of fundamental field. The other is that consciousness is prior to the physical world completely and has nothing to do with quantum mechanics. And I'd like to hear your views as to which is a better model for where our consciousness comes from and how it's related to the physical world.
I didn't hear it very well. Maybe you can ask the question, because I didn't hear it.
You didn't hear it. Oh,
I
no.
didn't hear it well.
Oh, I'm really in trouble.
I didn't hear
the
it
reason
well.
The reason I was saying that is because, I mean, I wouldn't presume, I don't know. I mean, I've read books, some books, layman's books on quantum mechanics, but I wouldn't even presume to be able to talk about how consciousness relates to quantum mechanics, whether quantum mechanics has anything to do with consciousness or not, because I don't know quantum mechanics enough.
I would be dishonest
if I said I knew enough about the field to actually intelligently comment on it.
Yeah, it was discussed this morning, I think, by one physicist about quantum mechanics and brain and microtubules and quantum phenomena through microtubules, and I'm aware of that. I've studied some. I don't claim to understand it. The way I think of it is the situation is really much more interesting than that, in my perspective, which is, it's like to say that consciousness is a quantum phenomena in the brain, it's like a chicken and egg story. It's like, because from her perspective of awakening or realization, the whole body is a manifestation within consciousness, including the brain and its microtubules. Consciousness is more fundamental, more ontologically the ground than the body and its brain. And the consciousness manifests, I mean, right this moment, I'm recognizing conscious awareness manifesting all of this physical body. This physical body manifesting Hamid talking. It's not, and the brain, thinking about the brain and the body is a way of looking at it from a perspective when we are not standing in the place of consciousness, place of awakening, and looking at things from a scientific point of view, which I think is a good point of view, is a valid point of view in the sense it's useful and practical, but we need to balance it with the fact that consciousness is more fundamental. So I think the theorist who is thinking about consciousness has to do with quantum properties of the brain need to balance that with the understanding that consciousness is ontologically prior than the brain itself. That, I don't know the answer, but that's how I think about it. Oh, so you already know that.
Thought you did well on that one.
You already knew it.
One more.
Hi, thank you.
Hi.
You mentioned that there's no end to this process. And so something without an end must not also have a beginning. So, I'm just curious to hear what you have to say about not only that there's no end, but that there's no beginning, and so that this process of spiritual growth is already happening regardless.
Well, here's the paradox, is that even though there's no end, at a certain point of the light's coming on, at a certain point of clarity, there's that we're living, in my experience, a quite amazing paradox, which that every moment, in other words, where you are, feels complete and sufficient. So in that sense, not that it's abstractly or philosophically the end, but it feels like an end, like an end in itself. Yeah. It is a completion. It feels totally complete. It doesn't feel, usually when we think of something's a process that goes on and on, you know, there's something that's like, oh my God, this, I'm done with processes that goes on and on and on and on. So if you understood it in that context, I think there would be something really vital that would be missed, which is even though it's endless, at each point of the Dharma feels totally and absolutely complete. In the sense of that there feels like there's nothing else, there's no insufficiency. And within that no insufficiency, within that sense of deep, deep experiential completeness, the next more complete thing shows up, right? And oh, and that feels complete. So you don't, at a certain point, you stop feeling like you're on a treadmill, always trying to get there but never arriving. Do you know what I mean? Part of, I think, the really being deeply realized is the sense, the feeling of arriving at each moment, but not in such a way that you've made a conclusion of finality. So you kind of get the best of both worlds in a certain sense, the deep rest of not struggling or seeking in the conventional sense, and the adventure and the joy of existence always revealing itself. You know, that's my experience anyway.
Yeah, I think that's a very nice way of saying it, that doesn't answer completely the question of beginning, but
no, shows I leave that lack. You.
But that's, no, it's already in the Bible. I don't have to say it. The Bible already said it. I can't contradict it. This was the beginning. The beginning. I'll be crucified. I said there's no beginning. Oh, God.
it just blew it all up.
I'm glad I'm not living in Syria these days.
But I think one thing, you know, in our discussion, it sounds like realization is a matter of pure awareness and, you know, and emptiness and vastness and then how to live that. In reality, as realization realizes further realization, what you come to is the simplicity of things. Things get much simpler. You don't care about emptiness. You don't care about awareness. You just drink your tea.
Yeah.
Talk to your friends. We're back to Zen again.
I love it.
You're back to Zen for some reason.
It's so true. It's so true, though. That's why I often tell people that, you know, I'm actually much more boring than you imagine. If you think I sit around talking like this all the time, you know, one can only take it for so much in any given day, you know. It's fun, but you do have to just have a cup of tea and forget it all. And so live it. Yeah. Live it.
Yeah, sometimes you have to go through all that stuff, the spiritual thing, you know, the spiritual journey, to arrive at simplicity. Mm-hmm. Because simplicity is the ordinary life without the usual self. Yeah. People don't know that. Most people think, if there's no ordinary self, you're this big, majestic thing. No, you can be no self. I'm nobody. Mm-hmm. I'm actually nobody, completely nobody. There's nobody here, no self, no person, no nothing. But, you know, I'm drinking my water, my beads broke. No. It's very simple. You know, there's going to be dinner soon. I could say I'm going to have dinner. You could say dinner happening. But it doesn't matter. You know, after a while, you don't care. There is a freedom. The freedom is really the complete, sort of another way of saying the completion, that I just saying that you're free. You know, there are, you know, you have limitation. There's a limitation. There's no limitation. Things become simple, and you don't bother yourself with it. And the important thing, you don't bother others with it.
Just as important.
Yeah. Yeah, that's how people know you realize when you don't bother other people with it. You see, that's the proof.
As they say in Zen, if you want to know the attainment of the master, ask his wife or her husband, whoever happens to be the master. They're the ones that know. Yeah. Don't ask the master. Forget it.
Yeah.
Ask the person they live with.
Exactly right, yes.
One more question.
Hi. 2 years ago, I came from Japan. And after coming here, I learned the power of Zen from American people. Then I want to ask, why do you love Zen and Japan? And do you have a message to...
Why do I have what?
Why do you love Zen and Japan? Japan.
Zen. Why didn't I do Zen in Japan?
Yeah, Zen and Japan.
Oh, why didn't I go there?
Love. Why do you love?
I'm sorry, hold on.
Why do you love? Why do you love Zen and Japan? Love.
The microphone is not working very well.
Hold on. Why do you love Zen and Japan?
Why do I love Zen?
And Japan.
And Japan.
Yes. And do you have a message to Japanese people?
Oh, I see.
Thank you.
I still don't know if I understand, but I'll give it a shot anyway. You know, I'll give it a shot anyway. What I loved about, what just attracted me to Zen when I was a young man was for whatever reason, I don't even know why. I really don't know why, because I had a good life, good parents, you know, got through pretty unscathed compared to most people, pretty happy, wasn't seeking to not suffer. But I read a book one day. It was an Alan Watts book, one of the first people that kind of brought, you know, some of the Zen ideas to here. And it had the word enlightenment. And I read the word just read the word. I didn't read what it was about or anything. And it was like a nuclear explosion went off inside of me. And at that instant, I knew my entire life trajectory has changed. I didn't understand why or what it was. I went on to read about enlightenment. I didn't understand any of it. But what I liked about Zen was, at least in theory, was the teacher was supposed to have had some realization, some enlightenment experience themselves. So they weren't just talking about passing along the theory and the ideas and all of that. And that really attracted me. If I'm going to talk to somebody about this, I want to talk to somebody who's experienced it to some extent. So that's what attracted me to Zen tremendously. That was my pull, you know. And then, of course, I loved the Zen masters that would never give. Well, they gave such straight answers that they never gave you a straight answer. You know, right? They're so straight. They're so concrete. They're so direct that unless you're in that state of directness, you can't understand them. And I appreciated that, even though it frustrated the hell out of me. Does that? I don't know if that answers the question. Yeah.
About Zen, I love Zen too, as all the stories I've been telling. However, I am a complete failure in it. I could not do it. I remember going to Zen Sashin. I said, I want to try Zen. I went to the San Francisco Zen Center. I went to Sashin, supposed to be 5 days. And they wanted us to go to sleep at 9 o'clock. I couldn't fall asleep till about 12 or 1 o'clock, and then they wake us at 4 o'clock. And I didn't have enough sleep. And then you have to sit on the Zafu for hours and eat on the Zafu.
Ouch.
Yeah, you have to eat on the Zafu. And I tried for 2 days. My back was hurting. I wasn't sleeping. But all these people sitting around, they're being quiet and facing the wall. I love the form, and I love the teaching, but I realized I can't do this. My body simply said no. Yeah. I can't do it. I can't wake up at 4 o'clock in the morning. I can't do it. It takes a few years to train myself, but I didn't want to do that. I didn't feel I could do that. And the other thing, my body just is because of my limitation, I couldn't sit on a Zafu straight back without my back hurting. It's not going to stop hurting just by sitting. And I realized that I just couldn't do it. And an interesting thing happened that day when I decided I wasn't going to do it. Suzuki Roshi arrived, but he was dead. He just died, and they brought him there. In the Zen center, we all meditated around him.
That was the session he passed away.
Yeah, that's the scene. Yeah. I thought, wow, I met Suzuki Kuroshi right there. So that's my story. But I study Zen. Dogen is one of my beloved teachers I learned from. I study his writing, his Shobogenzo, which I think has so much teaching, so much understanding, that many other kinds of teaching don't have. They don't know it. He was so developed in his understanding that I think he's just being discovered here, the breadth and depth of his teaching. So I really appreciate Zen that way.
The Zen teacher that I did retreat with, he used to say, only the crazy ones stay.
Yeah.
And I was one of the crazy ones.
Well, you made it at least. That was good.
And the last thing really quickly that I really appreciated about Zen too is that its real focus is to be able to live what you realize. As they often say, enlightenment is just the first step. To realize the absolute is not yet enlightenment, as the sutra says. And I always appreciated that. You don't go to a Zen master and walk in the door and say, I'm emptiness. You'll probably get a crack on the head with the stick.
you got to show them. And you got to have to show them, not just talk about it. And I always appreciated that. It was probably the greatest thing that I learned, the concreteness. As you said, drinking tea, highest expression of the Dharma you'll ever bump into.
Well, I mean...
Or anything else you have
exactly, drinking tea is the ultimate reality. Really?
Shaking
our hands is ultimate reality.
Yes.
Everything is ultimate reality. You know, when you see.
Mm-hmm. So, oh, what a beautiful note
thanks.
To close our conversation. Thank you very much for being with us and for bringing the lightness into this very serious topic. So I really appreciate that we can get to play.